In the long life of Winston Churchill, there have been many moments, great, tragic, poignant. One of the most poignant for him personally was an evening in 1955 when he was about to step down for the last time as Prime Minister, his work done. Britain's young queen, Elizabeth II, paid him the singular honor of dining with him at number 10 Downing Street. Who was this man the Queen came to honor? What forces shaped his career?
I'm a child of the House of Commons. I was brought up in my father's house to believe in democracy, trust the people. That was his message way back in those aristocratic Victorian days when, as Disraeli said, the world was for the few and for the very few.
His first monarch was also a queen, Victoria. For 63 years, this redoubtable woman ruled a Britain that enjoyed comparative peace, great prosperity, and unrivaled world power. Great houses were part of the life of Victorian England. This is Blenheim Palace, where Churchill was born, November 30th, 1874. A massive estate of 2,700 acres, Blenheim was built in the early 18th century with public money for John Churchill, the first Duke of Marlborough. Churchill's parents lived here, though they did not own the castle. His father was Sir Randolph Churchill, who rose in a brief meteoric career to be England's Chancellor of the Exchequer. Jennie Jerome, his mother, was a famous New York beauty who gave Winston his American connection. 1877, he was three. As a boy, he was difficult, often disobedient. The mistress of his dancing class said of him, "I used to think he was the naughtiest small boy in the world." At 12, he entered Harrow, and being a rebel, would not pose with his class. He did not distinguish himself. He flubbed Latin and mathematics, but Winston, the youngster at left, in his own words, "got into my bones the essential structure of the ordinary British sentence, which is a noble thing." Then to Sandhurst, Britain's West Point. Cadet Churchill, age 18. Commissioned a second lieutenant, he served as a soldier and newspaper reporter in five minor wars, the first of them being an insurrection in Cuba in 1895. The next year found him in India, playing polo, fighting the Pathan tribesmen, writing a bad novel, and reading Gibbon. Then on to Sudan with Kitchener and the Battle of Omdurman against the Dervishes, probably the last great cavalry charge in history. In 1899, Churchill, 24, resigned from the army, donned a war correspondent's uniform, and was off to South Africa. Here, the Boers, early Dutch settlers, were fighting to keep their independence from British control. Churchill plunged into the fray. Churchill was captured and slapped into prison. He quickly escaped and the Boers offered a £25 reward for him, dead or alive. Englishman, talks through his nose, cannot pronounce the letter S properly. Churchill, by then safe, whipped off a flamboyant dispatch to London to reassure the world. 1900, a now famous Churchill, who had rolled a lifetime of experience into his 25 years, was elected as a Conservative member of the House of Commons.
For us in Britain, the 19th century ended amid the glories of the Victorian era. And we entered upon the dawn of the 20th in high hope for our country, our empire, and the world.
In prosperous Conservative Britain, Churchill soon turned maverick. He broke with party leader Joseph Chamberlain, who opposed free trade and cheap food for the working man. "Chamberlain loves the working man," he quipped. "He loves to see him work." In 1904, he joined the rapidly rising Liberal Party under Lloyd George. As a Liberal, Churchill plumped